It's Comics Are Great, the visual storytelling show recorded live every other week at the Ann Arbor District Library in sweet yet rainy and gray Ann Arbor, Michigan. Comics.aadl.org. This is a show where we talk about making comics, writing comics, drawing comics, the lifestyle of a cartoonist, all the stuff that goes into this medium that drives us all mad. My name is Jerzy Drozd, cartoonist and teaching artist. And with me today, we got a new guest on the show. I'm so excited to talk to you. Speaking of sweet, one of the sweetest guys in comics, Jason Shiga, is here. Hey, Jason.
Hi, everybody. I'm Jason Shiga.
Now, we don't have video for you. Anybody who was watching the pre-show saw that we were having all sorts of video issues with getting you... getting your video feed pumped in through Skype. Thanks, Skype. Thanks for nothing. You're like the Amtrak of video conferencing. But we at least got your voice. You sound great. Now, Jason Shiga of ShigaBooks.com, meanwhile, is what you're widely known for. Also, Empire State from Abrams Books.
Yes, that's my most recent book.
Yeah, came out in 2011. A romance story or not. We'll talk about that today. Zurich Award winner, mini comic maker, indie self-publisher, web comic maker with your new comic, Demon. We're talking about all that stuff today, but I wanted to get you introduced because then I got to introduce the other guest who is not going to be here for very long today. We've got returning to the show, Dave Carter.
Hey, Jersey.
Hey, Dave. lib.umich.edu/minicomicsday.
That's right. Jersey, you've been gracious enough to allow me on your show yet again to plug the fourth annual Mini Comics Day at the Dude. That's the Duderstadt Center, which is on North Campus of the University of Michigan here in Ann Arbor. And the date for that this year is this coming Saturday. That's March 22nd, 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. And you can go online to lib.umich.edu/minicomicsday. where you'll find information about it and the sign-up link, so you can go and sign up. And it's when you sign up, that lets me know who's coming, so I know how much food to get. And it take you 30 seconds to sign up to let me know you're coming, so I certainly appreciate that. But I'm sure, Jersey, your first question is, what is Mini Comics Day?
Right. Are we turning into a 1950s science film strip? Gee, Mr. Carter, what is a mini comic?
I'm glad you asked, Lizzie. So at Mini Comics Day, what we do is we get a bunch of cartoonists and art students and librarians like me who have no business drawing comics all getting together in a room. And for 8 hours, we draw mini comics. And sort of the goal is to try to produce an 8-page mini comic in 8 hours. It's like a mini version of 24-hour Comics Day. And the great thing is just getting a bunch of people together who like comics, who like to draw comics, and you can sort of lock away everything from the outside world that's usually competing against your time, and just use that time to hang out with other people who like to make comics and just make comics. And we do it all by hand. People are sitting there with pen and pencil and paper and whatever other tool, crayons or colored pencils or, whatever markers, whatever you want to bring, and just making comics. And for those who are like professionals and stuff like that, it's a good time to sort of get back to the basics. For people like me who just normally just read comics, it's a great way to learn about what goes into making a comic. The first time I tried to make a comic of my own, I learned so much about, panel transitions and how much dialogue you can put into a single panel and all that kind of stuff that it seems to flow effortlessly when you're reading a professionally produced comic and you think, oh my gosh, this is hard. So even if you don't see yourself as a cartoonist, it's a good opportunity to learn firsthand about how comics are made.
Yeah, and it's a way to, comics is a solitary endeavor. It is often you at a desk alone, and it's nice to get out of the studio and go and be around people to, work together collaboratively, but necessarily, but to just work in the same space, right?
Right, right.
One of the things we talked about, we did, you and Maggie Ram were on the show last year or the year before, talking about our reflections on Mini Comics Day, and right. I think one of the things we talked about was when everybody hit that low point at the same time, where like you could hear everybody going like, oh, this is the point in the process where I feel like this is garbage and I'm no good and I have no business drawing this anymore. And then like we all came out on the other side at the same time and we were all cheering together. It's,
right, right.
It's a lot of fun. So March 22nd.
March 22nd, that's this Saturday. It's coming up really soon. So I brought some examples here I can show in the next couple minutes. I don't know. Can you see this on the?
Yeah. Yeah.
See that on there? So this is my comic from last year. It's the Secret History of the Space Monkeys. You can see that I use stick figures and not even good stick figures on that. And for this one, I took and I ended up taping in some old library catalog cards in it as part of the comic in that. So that was something new I sort of employed in doing that. So now let me show you like a good mini comic. here's an example from Matt Fuzell, who you've had Matt on the show before, haven't you?
Oh yeah.
So one of his many many comics. That's have to try to say that three times fast, but that. Here's one by Maya Gosling. She's part of one of the workers here at the library. She comes and she likes to make comics about rock climbing and working as being a cataloger and all that fun kind of stuff.
Here's the other thing. When you finish these books, if you finish them and get them photocopied there at the Duderstadt, because there's equipment there to get it printed, it gets added to the collection at the comics collection there. Yes.
Oh yeah, we don't force you to give a copy to us, but we certainly appreciate it, and so we get them into the collection. They get cataloged and put in, and for future generations to come and look at your work. And you know, one of the things I do is I bring mini comics from our collection to the Mini Comics Day, so you can look through them and kind of get inspired by what other people are doing. I just like mini comics because they're like so raw. It's kind of. Especially these ones that are just created in 8 hours, you don't have much time to ruminate and reflect necessarily. It's more of a, you know, it's your id and your ego putting out a comic without the superego getting in the way.
Well, Dave, we know that you got to get going because you got another meeting to get to. But thanks for taking time to stop by to remind us about Mini Comics Day.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me, and I hope to see people come and sign up and come on Saturday. Mini Comics Day, and it's great fun. So thanks again.
Thanks, Dave.
It's at lib.umich.edu/minicomicsday.
Indeed. All right, and have a great conversation with Jason.
All right, see you, Dave.
Yep,
all right. So, Jason.
You know, it's funny. Speaking of mini comics, it's, I think, pretty much 100% of the cartoonists I know my age got their start doing comics via mini comics.
That's how you got started too, isn't it?
That's how everyone I know got started, at least of my peers. Mm-hmm. I imagine, kids starting out today probably get their start with webcomics. But one... generation, one half generation ago, that was the way to get started.
You know, I wonder if we could just start there with this discussion, because I want to talk about like the whole arc of your career and what the takeaway is, and based on something you blogged about recently on your site. When you say like a lot of people maybe start a webcomic, but there's an implicit suggestion, and maybe this is my bias talking as an older guy who, you know, I was in my mid-20s when webcomics really took off. But there's an implicit suggestion in webcomics that you're in it for some kind of haul, right? And some people like Ryan Estrada, they do like, you know, limited things. But there's for the most part, I think, when you do a webcomic, it's like, I'm going to be doing this for a while. Whereas a mini comic, it's like, it is something you could do in an afternoon. And it is something where it's like, I could just fiercely throw out some ideas and not be too precious about it. And then also there's something valuable about watching the work stack up, right? I've got 12 mini comics now. I've got evidence. I've got artifacts of my effort. Whereas in web comics, like, well, I've got, you know, 75 comics in the archive, right?
Right.
So I'm just wondering if there's still like a value to doing mini comics just for the sake of it, right? Because of the benefits that come out of it. I mean, what benefits did you get out of doing mini comics when you were starting out?
Yeah, well, gosh, man. I mean, it was essentially my comics schooling, if I could put it that way. I guess now that there actually are schools, it's I guess things have completely changed. But the best way to learn something is by doing it, and you know, I think that applies to comics as well. Just hanging out with my friends, you know, making a comic, just learning what it takes to physically make a book. And then at the end, having a book that you can hold in your hands was, it was just such a great, great learning experience. A lot of people might see mini comics as sort of a stepping stone to getting picked up by a publisher or something, but I love mini comics, and I, you know, I'm still making them.
Same here. No, I adore them. I adore the notion that it's a way to stay limber about your craft, and it's a way to engage with the whole artistic arc that Kazuo Kibuishi famously, you know, talked about a while back, where he's talking about, you know, you start out going like, this is going to be great, and then the middle part you go, this is terrible, I'm terrible, no, it wasn't so bad, oh, that was that was awesome, I want to do it again, you know.
Yes.
You do that in a graphic novel, like say like Empire State, where it's like, what is this thing? There's like 200 something pages.
I'm not sure. I think 150, 180.
It's a lot of pages, a lot of panels, right? There's a lot of opportunities here for you to feel rotten about the process. Right, to let the ennui set in, when not that the book's bad, but the process of you know, engaging with it every day. Whereas with a mini comic, you just get it out, go through the whole cycle in an afternoon. But there was something else you said in there that I thought was really cool, is that you're also, if you don't have any experience doing like book layout, pagination,
you know,
setting up flats for a printer, quote unquote, in our case of mini comics, a photocopy machine.
Yes.
Yeah, it's good practice for all that stuff.
Yeah, no, I mean, you learn every step of the process.
It's true.
And yeah, I mean, just from coming up with the idea to printing, watching the pages fly out of the copy machine.
And also there's like a sense of the artist touched this. Like, okay, so here I've got in my hands, I've got Empire State, published by Abrams. Beautiful book, gorgeous book. And then I've got Knock Knock, which is hand-bound, hand-photocopied, and, you know, personalized to me, which was also nice. But I feel like, you know, Jason put this thing together from scratch. Jason made this thing with his hands, whereas this is like, yeah, he did that with this too, but, you know, it went to a printer and it was a digital file and so on, right? There's something about that artist's, like, you know, that personal, artisanal? I don't know what that is, touch. But anyway, so okay, well, but I think it's cool that you still like to make them, because I do too, and you know, I like this idea that you're an Ignatz winner, you're an Eisner winner, you got won the Zurich Award, you know, you're a decorated cartoonist, you've got good reviews, lots of people, you know, Time, there's an article on Time, article on in Wired about you, you know, you don't need to mess around with this rinky dink stuff anymore, yet you like to, because.
I love it. I love mini comics. What can I say? It's I don't want to repeat myself, but yeah, just going from a thought in your head to having a physical object, you know, that you can hold in your hands.
Really quick.
It's hard to think of another way to do that as quickly as mini comics.
All right, so let's back up then, and I want to walk through just briefly your career and get to my big $20,000 question, okay? So you started out with Double Happiness. You started out before that, but Double Happiness was the project where you got the Zurich Award. Now,
that's right.
To bring people up to speak, because like nowadays, I mean, there may be cartoonists who don't know what the heck that is, but that, you know, 10 years ago, you know, 12 years ago, the Zurich Award was kind of a big deal.
Oh my gosh. You mind if I just talk about the Zurich grant for?
Yeah, please.
It's one of those things. It's just been such an influential part of so many cartoonists' careers. it just, you know, I mean, if you look at the, if you look, if you go to Wikipedia or whatever and look at the list of Zarek winners, over the, you know, over the, over its run, it's, yeah, it's just like a who's who of, you know, alternative cartoonists working today. So like, I forget who, especially in the early rounds, like you'll see names like, Tom Hart and Adrian Tomine, Jessica Abel,
wow,
Gene Yang, Derek Kirk Kim,
that's right.
Yeah, all these names. And yeah, it's basically to go a little bit into the history, I guess it was started by Peter Laird. He was one of the creators of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Mm-hmm. And he got to start making Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles essentially as an alternative comic. He just raised the funds, hired a printer, printed a few thousand copies of his book, and that's basically how the Turtle Empire got started. And I guess now that they're both gazillionaires, I guess he thought it would it'd be a great idea and to start this grant for cartoonists who kind of wanted to do the same. And I think he's given away over $1 million at this point.
Wow.
Via the Zarek grant. So, it's an amazing grant. Unfortunately, it ended a couple years ago.
Yeah.
But yeah, it just it changed so many cartoonists' lives.
Well, you said specifically
so many careers.
On your blog, you said it was literally a life-changing amount of money for me and reshaped my entire career and life trajectory. Those are the words you used to describe what it was like getting the Zarek grant. So
yeah.
How so? How did it like change your life trajectory?
It's one thing to make 20 copies of your mini comic and sell them at the local comic book store.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, once you're, I guess the Zarek grant I got was for $5,000. And I basically printed up 3,000 copies of my book, which, is probably... hundreds of times more than my highest print run mini at that time. So the numbers, the quantities, the money, all that stuff involved just kind of forced me to think about comics more seriously.
Well, yeah, I remember the application form for the Zarek grant. It really, it's a grant. And if for those listening or watching who don't know about grant writing, they want to know what you're going to do with every penny of that money. It's not just like, is your stuff good? Yeah, you deserve $5,000 to print it up. No, they want to know what printer you're going to go through, what distribution method that you've chosen, what kind of production quality are you going to do it in color, are you going to do it in black and white, what methods are you going to use to promote this thing, to get it into the hands of people. They want you to basically set up as a small business in order to, so not only does the work have to be good, but you have to have a plan around that work, right?
Right.
So did writing that grant affect how you approached later works?
To be honest, I basically just copy and pasted Gene Yang's Zarek grant. Gene Yang got a Zarek grant a couple years before me, and I asked him if I could take a look at his grant application. So
there's a first bit of advice in grant writing. Find a friend and copy. Oh, that's great.
I didn't actually think about it too seriously until I actually got it. And then at that point, I was like, oh, crud, what am I going to do?
Yeah, you still got to make good on all those promises that were in that grant, right?
Right. And I guess the thing is, you can't, it's $5,000, but they don't just write you a check for $5,000. You can't just buy $5,000 worth of video games or whatever. You actually have to either give them quotes, and then they'll reimburse you for the amount in the quote, or you give them receipts and they'll reimburse you for the amount on the receipt. So yeah, at that point it was kind of like that movie's Brewster's Millions, where I was just like, oh crud, how am I going to spend $5,000? And then, yeah, I remember like at the end I'd only used up like $4,500. I was like, oh, I still have $500 I need to spend. And, wow, you know, I've only got 1 week to spend $500 on something. And I remember I walked into the post office and asked for $500 worth of stamps.
Did you get them?
Yeah.
That's awesome.
I sent them the receipt for $500 worth of stamps, and they reimbursed me for it.
They weren't forever stamps at that time, were they?
No.
It was
really, the unfortunate part was, I think just like a few months later, they raised the price by like 3 cents. So then I had to buy all these 3 cent stamps, and it took me years to go through all those stamps.
Oh my gosh.
But I didn't want that money to go to waste, except I guess it wouldn't really be wasted, cause it'd just be going back to Peter Laird. But yeah.
Yeah. But it was earmarked for you, right? So make use out of it. Okay, yeah. So there, we start with this, you know, here you are doing this comic and you got a grant, which it's a prestigious grant, right? There's like an air of quality around the word Zurich, right? We know that they only choose really worthy works to be selected for that. But here's the downside. You got to think like a business. You have to think about, you know, all of the production, and you have to manage all these finances, even though it's essentially found money. You have to use it responsibly. You couldn't just go out to, you know, In-N-Out Burger and spend $5,000 on fries. So then we get to, you know, later on in your career, Meanwhile comes out, and it gets traction. And for those who haven't seen Meanwhile, it's a choose-your-own-adventure book where we've talked about it on the show before.
Wait. Before we get to Meanwhile, can I talk a little more about the Zurich grant?
Oh, please.
What actually happened with this book?
Sure. No, I want to hear it. Yeah.
Okay, so... sorry to interrupt you, but it's...
Yeah. No, man, this is your show, man. I want to hear it.
It's a funny story. So, okay. So anyways, I got the money. I think this is a pretty common experience with Zurich winners, but they don't know exactly how to spend it or what to do or how to turn that into books. It was so difficult trying to figure out like Diamond and how to navigate that whole thing and printers, and oh my gosh, it was such a headache. But I finally did it. And I think I got 700 orders for my book. And I figured I didn't time it quite right, because normally you're supposed to get the orders and then send the print job. But I contacted the printers first. I was like, print up 3,000 copies of my book. I wanna max out the the Zurich money.
Right.
So basically I think I sold about 1,000 altogether when all was said and done.
So do you still have some copies of Double Happiness?
So for a while I had about 2,000 copies of Double Happiness just in the house. And yeah. I had them in these boxes. They came direct from the printer. And I basically stacked the boxes in such a way that it made a giant armchair. So yeah, people would just come to my house and sit on this. It looked more like a throne that was just made out of copies of Double Happiness. And maybe every 3 or 4 years I'd break open one of the boxes. But yeah, at a certain point, I was just like, "There's no way. There's no way I can get rid of all these books." And I'm sorry to say, I think after 6 or 7 years, I just recycled all of those books.
Oh man, no, I hear you. My very first self-published work I did in 1994, and I went through all of the traditional distribution channels like you do, and I did the same thing where I was like, I'm gonna need 2,000 copies because this is gonna be big, because this is awesome, And then I solicited, and I think I got like 4 orders that I had to mail out. And then, like, with the unit cost, because, you know, Diamond took like, it's, what is it, 60% or something like that? I forget because I haven't gone through Diamond since. But like, it wound up costing me money to get those books out. And I still have, I think I have like 300 copies left of that print run that I can't bring myself to get rid of. But for many years, like, I'd move from apartment to apartment. I'm like, why am I still carrying around all these books?
I guess another thing is the way printing works is, I forget the exact numbers, but it was like, you know, something like, you know, for $2,000, you know, we can print up 1,000 copies of Double Happiness. But for $2,300, we can print up 3,000.
Yeah.
So I was just like, why not just kick them an extra, you know, few hundred dollars? I can get 3 times as many.
Right. Yeah. The way the print. But see, that's the kind of thing that you only learn when you actually engage with those kinds of companies. You didn't know that. Well, your background is in mathematics, actually. That's what your degree is in, right?
Right.
But even when you're going to art school, when I was going to school, that wasn't something that we were taught. It's something you learn by just going out and doing it, right?
Right.
So that's one of the cool things about things like the Zarek Grant. And now we got Kickstarter, which kind of filled that gap and kind of democratized it in a way. Like, now anybody, you know, there's no committee deciding. The committee is the public. You know, right. Can you reach the public and do they approve?
I haven't confirmed this, but I suspect the advent of Kickstarter was probably one of the reasons they decided to end the Zarek Grant. Hmm.
It seems like it could have. I haven't been following the news closely on that, and like I just remember reading a little story about it when they decided to close the doors on it. But it seems like something like that could still exist as a prestigious award, right? It's not only the money, but it's also, this is a juried thing where getting this is kind of like getting an Eisner, kind of like getting an Ignatz, right? You know, it's your peers saying this is worthy, more people should pay attention to it, right?
Right.
Whereas Kickstarter, yeah, you can get funding. You can get a lot of funding, actually, if you're crazy good at, you know, working your hustle. But is that the same as being able to put the little laurels like they put in front of indie movies? I don't know.
I don't know. I mean, personally, I'd rather have the money.
I guess you're right. As they say, it talks, right? But you know, it's like you don't need the money anymore, right? Because Abrams, hello, you're published by the big boys now. This book is in bookstores everywhere. And they take care of a lot of that hustle for you. You didn't have to talk to printers. You didn't have to work with distributors. All you had to do was produce the work with your editor, you know, craft into the best thing it could be, maybe work with some designers to get the cover design and maybe some of the interior things worked out. Headache removed.
Right? Yes.
So now you just
oh my gosh, and the best part, I never have to cut out a single tab again.
Oh, that's right.
I don't know if you have the mini comic version of Meanwhile, but
I've seen pictures, and that was actually a question I had slated was, were you hand cutting all those tabs in the Meanwhile?
Yes. Oh, so every God. Single one of those tabs in the mini comic version, I cut myself by hand. There's 72 pages in each copy of Meanwhile. So that's about 72 tabs I had to cut just for one copy. And I remember working it out. I must have printed or self-published about 1,000 copies over the course of the mini comics run. So,
wow.
Oh my gosh. When Abrams told me they wanted to do Meanwhile, I was dancing a little jig. I was just like, oh my gosh, never again. I'll never have to cut out another tab.
We've got machines that can do that, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So, and then we get to, I'm gonna fast forward a little bit, and the reason I'm fast forwarding is because I know we're gonna come back to talking about Empire State and Meanwhile as we reflect on where I'm going with this. But now you're doing a webcomic.
That's right.
Webcomics are for starting things up. It's for people who don't have a publisher. It's for people who don't have an agent. Why are you doing webcomics? That's silly talk. You have the machinery in place to make your dreams come true. Why go back to just creating a WordPress site and sharing your comics that way?
I guess, yeah, I mean, I guess, yeah, I, well, Jersey, I'm not going to lie to you. It's Abrams didn't want to publish Demon.
Oh, okay. So this is the web is where you put your failures. No, but you said yourself, there's a blog post on shigabooks.com where you were explaining why this is a webcomic. So it's a book called Demon.
Yes.
And you said that it's pure insanity. And, I mean, I've been reading it, and it's this guy who wakes up every afternoon. I think it's afternoon because it's like 1:13 when he wakes up, right?
Uh-huh.
And tries to kill himself. And he succeeds every time. But then he wakes up the next day in some kind of weird Groundhog's Day thing. But the evidence of his past failures keeps showing up. So, like, he blows his brains out, wakes up the next day, there's the bullet in the wall. So he clearly did it. So what's going on here? I don't know if there's anything you wanted to add on to that elevator pitch for what Demon is.
That's a great elevator pitch. I haven't come up with a good one myself, but basically you don't have to worry about this failed suicides a story going on for 700 pages.
We're only at the beginning. I mean, you've got like a progress meter on the comic, and we're only like what, like 4%, 8% in, or something like that.
Yes. Yeah. So the whole thing is going to be about 750 pages when it's done. I guess the original plan was I would release it in issues. Each issue would be around 36 pages, and I guess at the maybe at the end it would be collected into a graphic novel or volumes of a graphic novel. That part I hadn't worked out yet. But I guess what I really wanted to do was make an issue comic book. Pamphlets, because that's actually the one thing that I've never done. I've done minis, I've done strips, graphic novels. I did those strips for those one page strips for Nickelodeon magazine. But I've always wanted to do floppies, like a serial story that comes out every month, and then at the end of the issue, it ends on some crazy cliffhanger, and you're like, oh, what's going to happen next? And you have to wait a month and then to continue the story. I came up with this, I don't want to spoil too much, I came up with this, idea for a story, about, essentially this guy who cannot die. For reasons that will be explained pretty soon. And I pitched it to Abrams, but there's a few reasons I don't think they wanted to go with it. Well, first of all, they don't do floppies. Mm-hmm. And I guess not a whole lot of publishers do these days. I'm maybe Drawn and Quarterly. They still do Optic Nerve, but man, it's hard finding publishers that
outside of the ones that are doing like superhero or licensed stories, right? But Image is like the last place I think that I can think of where you, like a creator owned thing can be a magazine style comic, right?
Right.
Yeah.
There are some format issues with Abrams, and then also. This story, Jersey, this story is crazy.
I'm looking at the update that updated today, which is when we're recording this, is March 19th, 2014. Oh, it was this week. It was Monday. Yeah, and I'm looking at the main character, who happens to look very similar to the character from Meanwhile, as he's looking at his decapitated corpse on a bathroom floor. So,
Jersey, let me... that's nothing.
Oh, no.
Wait, man, wait till you see what happens in a few hundred pages.
Oh, my.
Well, okay, I won't spoil it for you, but oh, my gosh. When you see what happens, you're gonna pee in your pants. You're gonna be like, what? No, why? Anyways, but yeah. Anyway, so it's complete insanity.
Yeah.
So I think that's probably another reason they didn't want to publish it.
Did it have anything to do with target audience, like being able to define? Because I know that that's like super important in the book publishing world. Is like, who is this for? What shelf do we put this on? Is that part of the difficulty that you ran into?
It might have been, but they didn't say so. So who knows? Who really knows what goes on in the minds of publishers?
Now, I've had my share of rejection letters, and usually it'll just be something along the lines of, it didn't tickle us. I'm like, okay, well, what specifically did it, you know? Like, what could I fix about it? But here's an interesting thought. You got these books, these critically acclaimed books published. They presumably doing very well, yet it's not any kind of insulation from, you know, rejection. That can still happen.
Yes. Man, let me tell you, I feel with comics, with every project, you're starting from the beginning. It's great that way because, you're constantly having to, you know, rethink and innovate and try new things. It's, you know, it kind of forces you not to sort of get stuck in, you know, some repetitive pattern. Sometimes I wish there was a little more stability in this field.
Yeah. Well, it's like it takes me back to what I thought when I was a kid, is like when I was like a teenager thinking like, well, I'm just going to draw Amazing Spider-Man because I'm awesome at this thing. And that'll be that. You know, I won't have to worry about things anymore because life will just be like good after that. You don't think like you think that it's like you quote unquote make it and then it'll just be stable after that, because that's probably informed by the story we tell ourselves as Americans, this idea of like, well, you just get a job and clock in for 20 years. But
it's not like, I don't know, it's not like getting a union job at a, you know, car company or something where it's like, okay, yes, I'm in. But I guess if people like the comic that you're making, then it's great. And, you know, every project is a new thing. I guess there are careers, I don't know, someone like Kathy Gusweiss or whatever can do, variants on a similar story for decades and decades. Mm-hmm. If you're making books, sort of standalone, graphic novel type books, it's tough.
Oh, I like this idea. Like you said, with every project, you're starting from the beginning, starting from scratch, which can be terrifying, but also can be very liberating, right? Yeah. So, a story I told on the show before is I was once talking with a friend of mine about a project I wanted to do, and I started talking about, oh, I'm going to market it this way, and I'm going to reach these audiences with it, and it's going to be done in this format, and I'm going to release it in this kind of a schedule, and it'll be really, I think this is a really rock-solid method of releasing, publishing, and marketing this thing. Uh-huh. And my friend said to me very calmly and almost sagely, you do know your first priority is to make a really good story, right? And I was like, oh, yeah. And like at first I was like, no, it's all about getting it to the right people. And then like after I thought about it, I was like, oh, yeah, he kind of had a point. So this is the big question that I wanted to try to wrap our brains around to you know, because I titled this one, you know, it's like puzzling out your comics destiny. You've done it all. You've done mini comics. You've done self-published comics. You've been published. Now you're doing web comics. And I'm wondering, after swimming in all these different pools for the past 15 plus years, how has your thinking changed about what comics you'd like to make? And then the second part of the question is, when you're thinking about this, how do you think about where you'd like that comic to live? Right. So like when I was listening to you talk about Demon, you're like, I got this idea for this thing. It's got these crazy ideas. Boy, I'd like to do a pamphlet. And like, I heard some reasoning in there that was like, I've never done a pamphlet. That'll be fun. But then I'm guessing there was something about the kind of story that it is that like you thought it would live well in a pamphlet, or was it just like kind of a whimsical decision?
One thing I like to do is I like to design my stories around the format that it's in. Mm-hmm. So I guess to take an extreme example, sometimes, you know, I'll play around with a piece of paper and then I can figure out, I can fold this into a hexatetraflexagon if, you know, I cut it here and then fold it up here like this. and then I have the form, right? Uh-huh. I have this hexatetraflexagon. I'll think, okay, what kind of stories can I put onto this form? That's an extreme example.
Uh-huh.
I don't come up with the story first and then try to construct the flexagon around it. Mm-hmm. Even with less extreme formats like the floppy format. For example, with Demon, I'd like to start with the format first, which is a floppy, and then think, what's great about floppies? You know, what's really fun about them? And I guess for me, one of the fun parts of the floppy is I think it was Art Spiegelman who said comics is what happens between the panels. So for me, one of the greatest parts of the floppy is what happens between the issues. I don't know if you read that, the David Boring story by Dan Klaus, but there's that great moment at the end of the first issue that ends with a guy firing a gun, and there's a bullet in the very last panel of the issue. There's a bullet hanging in the air. Coming straight at the main character's face, and then I think it was a year before that before we got the second issue. So for a whole year, I just remember there's this bullet just floating in the air, and it was driving me nuts. And I was just like, oh, how's he gonna get out of it? Yeah,
so the format or the form of the thing can inform what the story is for you.
Oh yes, definitely.
Interesting. But the demons. I mean, did it start with, boy, I want to do a floppy. What can I do with a floppy? And then Demon came along, or did you have a rough idea of Demon, and then you're like, I wonder what I could do with this? Hey, you know what? A floppy. I wonder how that would change what the story is.
More the second.
Okay.
I've had the premise of Demons sort of kicking around in my head for a while.
Okay.
It was sort of more nebulous. But when I got the idea that I wanted to do a floppy, or I wanted to do a serial story, it really started to coalesce into the story that Demon became.
All right, when did the decision happen to say, well, I'll do it as a webcomic? And this is my second part of the question: did that inform or change the way the story came together when you decided, well, I'll do it as a webcomic?
So let's see. I don't want to insult any webcomics people, but to be perfect. Okay, well,
you did put on your blog that when your friend Derek Kirk Kim was experiencing all this wonderful success with his webcomic Same Difference,
yes.
I remember that was a big deal when it was updating. And he was at a million page views on its final update, and he got all this attention, and your response was, phooey.
for the longest time, I was kind of a web comic skeptic. Mm. I was very anti-webcomic. I think At some point, kind of as a concession, I just scanned a bunch of my comics and put them up on my website. But I guess I don't even know if by definition, actually, I don't even know what the definition of webcomics are, but I'm pretty sure that wouldn't really qualify as a webcomic, whatever definition you use. I started to come around to the idea of webcomics maybe a year or two ago, when I was selected as a judge for the Ignatz Award, and they basically dumped, oh my gosh, hundreds and hundreds of webcomics into my lap. Oh my gosh, it was crazy. I read a lot of comics, like physical comics for the, as a judge for the Ignatz Award, but oh my gosh, for every one of those physical comics, I must've read like a dozen, web comics. There's just so many web comics. I still don't know how many web comics there are. There's just so many of them. Actually, you may have talked with someone who knows more about web comics than me, but I don't even know if anyone has a sense of how many there are at this point.
There's probably no way of really knowing for sure how many there really are. It's got to be almost countless. There's like you also did a blog post recently about like, are we past the golden age of webcomics, because you were looking at, what was it, a Wikipedia article, wasn't it?
Yes.
And it was citing like, here's the notable webcomics that came out in this year, and like, and it starts out in the 90s and there's only a couple, and then you get to like the early 2000s and it just explodes, this whole bunch, and then it starts to taper out again when we get into like 2011, 2012. Not as many are popping up. But, you have to wonder if that's a signal-to-noise ratio kind of thing, where there's so many now that, there's a lot of good ones. You know, I can name, like, a dozen really good webcomics off the top of my head. Right. But how many are there total? Who knows? It's ridiculous. But that's great, right? That's a good thing. I mean, everybody has access to the pool, as it were.
Yeah.
But here you are reading these. Flip, yes. flip, you know, and like, I can't even imagine trying to read, you know, hundreds of web comics in a several month period. That was like a real job, I bet.
Oh my gosh, it was so many. I feel bad about admitting this, but I did not read every panel of every web comic that was sent to me.
How could you? You couldn't. I mean, not with numbers like that, no.
At a certain point, I just had to limit myself. You know, I'll read three. If it's a strip, I'll read three strips.
Yeah.
If it's a story, you know, I'll read a few pages. And then, even then, oh my gosh, it just took months to read them, to read all of these. But I guess the great part, or sort of the eye opener for me, was just seeing all this creativity out there in the field. It sort of reminded me of when I just started out and first discovered mini comics, and just realized, what are these things? There's so many of them. Who? What? Where? Or maybe, I don't know if you've ever been to France or Japan and just, walking into a comic book store there and just seeing,
variety.
All these titles that you have no idea what they are, and entire genres that you didn't know existed. So, it was just, that was probably one of the biggest eye-openers for me. Just seeing the immensity of the field. Other things like, I guess the advent of tablets, for whatever reason, I need to hold the thing that I'm reading. Mm-hmm. So until tablets came along, it was really tough for me to sit in front of a monitor and read webcomics. Just other little incremental improvements in technology along the way.
So it's the platform's matured a little bit, like enough to where you can, you know, it's not as big a leap for you to say, okay, this is enough like a traditional reading experience that I can play now.
Yeah.
Yeah. But also, I love that idea, like, you know, when you talked about going back to what you said, with every project you're starting from the beginning, what better way to start a new thing than to refresh yourself by saying, oh, here's a whole bunch of examples of people who are not taking the medium for granted and are doing all sorts of interesting things and just sharing whatever, right? And now I can come back to this thing afresh.
Yes.
Did when you decided, all right, I'll come into this webcomics thing after all, did that change the way you wrote Demon, or was Demon pretty crystallized by then?
Demon was pretty crystallized by then. I'd actually penciled the whole thing out, because I wanted to have every single page penciled, but by the time I submitted it to Abrams. So the whole thing's penciled out. There's not too much that changed since I decided to turn it into a webcomic.
Wow. You thumbnailed or sketched or penciled 700 pages. No wonder. Yeah, you said you've been working on this for 3 years, so holy cow.
I guess right now I'm just going through and inking the pages, and as I ink them, I put them up online, one page every weekday, and I guess I am now making a webcomic. that's kind of how it came to be. I wish I could tell your listeners that I was the plan from the very beginning, but I think this is
the stuff that I think is so fascinating. You know, my favorite thing in the world when I'm discussing these kind of topics with cartoonists is not the advice, but the moments where you are vulnerable and you say, you know, I was trying to figure it out. I thought I was supposed to go this way, but it turned out I was supposed to go that way. That is so much more interesting to me than somebody going, all right, well, this is how you do a webcomic. You sit down and you, right? You use these kind of plugins, you update this kind of these days a week, and then you're going to get this kind of fan base, and then you make these kind of t-shirts, right? Any artist worth their salt is never going to tell you that, right? I think what's interesting here is that there was a lot of different factors informing this decision to make Demon into a webcomic, right? You tried it through the publishing route. There was friction there. Okay, well, let's do pamphlets. There's friction there. All right, I'm whittling down to what this thing needs to be. It's almost like the circumstances are acting as cooperators with your own desires to make the thing. Does that sound terribly poetic and dumb?
No, that sounds great. That's about the shape of things. That's my life story. Just not having any clue what I'm doing and stumbling into things and just trying to figure things out as I go along.
But it starts with, going back to that advice my friend gave me, it starts with having a good idea for a story or a good story or a neat thing that is inspired by a moment of curiosity about form, right? What could I make out of a hedron that you were making. I want to say it wasn't a dodecahedron. What was the shape?
It was a flexagon.
A flexagon.
Yes, it was a hexatetraflexagon.
A hexatetraflexagon. How many sides are on that thing?
I guess it depends how you want to count sides, but, yeah. There's basically two sides. It's not a Mobius strip if you unfold the whole thing.
Okay.
It's, uh,
See, I was imagining something like a 400-sided die kind of thing, which I've seen people make comics on things like a 20-sided die or something like that. I saw a Rubik's Cube recently where somebody turned it into a comic that you could like mix up, which I thought was really cool.
Oh, yeah. Was this the Peter Conrad one?
Maybe. It was at the it was at the art show in Columbus. I'm forgetting the name of the gallery, and I'm going to feel like a jerk for forgetting the name of the gallery. Somebody in the chat room help me out. but I think that might have been it.
That one was great. That one was fantastic.
Yeah. But I like that idea too of like, you know, like let the form inform part of the actual narrative piece of the thing as well. Because there's another theme that we've discussed on the show in the past is limitations inspire creativity, right? Like the more limitations you put on the thing, the harder it is to get out of it, the more creative solutions you have to come up with in order to solve the problem, right? Because a lot of times storytelling is solving problems.
Yes.
Okay, well, we got book recommendations in a minute here. I want to make sure that I give you a chance for a final thought on this thing about, how to decide what project to do and in what form it should have. Did I miss anything on that whole topic, Jason?
Oh, man, I guess, I'd say if I could give advice to people starting out, I'd say don't try not to worry too much about the money side of things. Who was it that you had? Spike Trotman?
Yeah, Spike Trotman. Yeah.
She had some really excellent advice about Kickstarter. Mm-hmm. And that was actually one of the things that was kind of an eye-opener for me. But I guess a lot of there's been some real like blockbuster Kickstarter campaigns recently. I don't know if you've seen them, but they're getting like $100,000 or something crazy.
Yeah, some webcomics raised $1 million. What was it? Order of the Stick did that a couple years back, right?
Yeah, I saw
Bonkers.
That was crazy.
Yeah.
I don't know. Comics is always sort of this weird. I don't know. It's this weird medium because it's both commerce, right? You're making these, either physical booklets or web comics, in exchange for money. So there's this. I feel there's sort of a lot of pressure for cartoonists starting out either turn it into a profession or
I got to make the marketable thing. I got to make the thing that people want, and I got to find out what people want and make that thing, right?
Right.
Yeah.
If I could give any advice, I'd say, don't worry about that stuff. You just got to think about, making the best comic that you can make. That's what I would. That's what I would recommend.
Which is, it sounds so simple that it almost sounds like something mom would say at graduation, right? But when you sit down to do it and you try to make the best comic you can make, oh my gosh, is it hard? That is like the hardest thing ever and one of the most profound challenges you could possibly take on, right? Because so much is going on every page. So
it's, I don't want to be negative, but oh my gosh, when I walk around a comic convention, there's so many comics where
there's a lot of half-hearted attempts. Yeah. Can we put it that way?
I'm going to get the name wrong. Well, it's probably for the best. But, yeah, someone was selling a comic called, like, Crappy Comics or Shitty Comics or something. That was the title of their comic. I wanted to go up to this guy and say, why are you doing this?
Right, right.
Take some pride in your work, man.
I'm going to open up a restaurant called Stinky Food. I would open up a fast food place called Botulism. How about that? No. There's a fine line between self-depreciating humor and, you know, putting yourself down publicly, right?
I've got a kid now. I've got a baby. Every, you know, when I wake up in the morning, I think, you know, every comic could be my last one. I gotta make this one count.
Has he said dad yet, by the way?
Not really.
Oh.
He knows the words for up.
Yeah.
He can say up. He knows the word for Pinocchio. milk.
But not dad.
Not dad. Or pa or whatever. I don't know.
It'll come.
My ego's a little bruised, to be honest.
But I do like that idea too, that it's I don't want to start putting like anxiety about the Grim Reaper into the discussion, but this kind of sense that, you know, once you make a really big project, and Jason, you've made a bunch of really big books, length, right? A lot of work goes into these things, and you start to realize as you get a little older, it's like, oh, I only got X amount of books left if I live to this age, right? So yes. I better be careful about what I choose to do, and I better make sure that's something that I really, really care about and not fritter away some time on something just because, oh, well, Dad says this is a good idea for a book.
Yes.
Empire State.
That's great advice. Frame it that way. Frame it that way, youth of today. You know, you only have 7 books in you. Don't waste one of those books on a book called Crappy Comics. You really want that to be one of your 7? No. By the way, my apologies to the creator of Crappy Comics. I didn't actually read your comic. I just saw the title.
You're pointing out what that title telegraphs to you as a consumer, right?
Disclosure. For all I know, the Crappy Comic is a wonderful comic. So yeah, just my apologies.
And it might be a joke of irony. And so, but you're pointing out how the messaging is problematic in that situation, right?
Yes.
But yeah, Empire State was a personal work, right? I mean, this thing was based on a real life experience, and I don't think it's autobiographical per se, right? But no, it's vaguely. Yeah, I mean, you have this young man traveling across the country by bus and meeting characters that I hope you didn't meet in real life, Jason. But then going, you know, this boy from Oakland, oh, you happen to be from the Oakland area, going to New York and experiencing something. And this is one thing I want to end with a compliment to you. One of the things I love about your work, both the choose-your-own kind of comics, but then also your, you know, just general fiction comics, is you don't walk away from ambiguity. And one of the things that a choose-your-own adventure kind of story invites is ambiguity. Is it going to be this way or is it going to be that way? You get to choose. And then in Empire State, even though it's a linear narrative, but it ends. Oh, I don't want to spoil the ending for people. People need to read it. But it ends in this way where, you know, somebody says, "Look out the window," and he looks out the window. And I don't think you could have chosen a better moment to say, like, "Is it better or worse for him now?" It was a lovely way to end the book. So. But yeah, I would say that anybody who's a big fan of ambiguity and storytelling should definitely read Jason Shiga's work.
Oh, well, thank you very much.
That's not an easy thing to do, you know, to let people walk in with their own assumptions about things and get to make their own interpretation of things. There's a real art to that. Tim Pham is another guy who does that really well. Sumo ended in a very similar way, where like it got a little goosebumpy.
Yeah.
I can only aspire to be able to have that kind of poetic ambiguity in my work. So, okay, we're going to get to book recommendations. Rachel Moyer is in the room with...
Hi, Rachel.
Hi there.
PLA at the Ann Arbor District Library, which is a... remind me what that is again?
My go-to metaphor is Library Padawan, but...
Library Padawan.
Yeah, it means I'm still in library school, but they're nice enough to let me work here and learn all the inside secrets, so...
Are you one of the good Padawans or the whiny Padawans?
I like to think I'm one of the good Padawans, but I mean, I can't really speak to that.
Continuing the Star Wars metaphor, they come in two varieties. They either come in like, yes, master, I will do what you say, or, oh, but come on, master, I want to do a cool teenager thing.
Not going to Tosche Station to pick up some power converters.
Well, I just started watching Clone Wars, and I noticed that there's like those kinds of themes kind of pop up in there. But anyway, mm-hmm. So yes, you are a Padawan. You are studying to be a librarian. You are doing the work of a librarian, and you are engaging in all the responsibilities of a librarian without the title.
That's right, yep. And I get to do all the fun stuff like recommend comics.
So. All right, so Jason, I warned you that we'd be doing some book recommendations. I'm going to let Rachel go first while you sum up your thoughts on any that you might have, okay?
All right.
All right, so what do you got for us, Rachel?
All right, I got three things this time, which I think is becoming my standard. So I'm starting off here with Thor the Mighty Avenger. This is a couple years old.
Is that the Roger Langridge one?
It is, and Chris Samnee. It was a short-run series, and which is very sad because it's a very excellent series. It's out of continuity, which mm-hmm. is pretty great for someone who is starting comics because, you know, we all love how much detail you can get, I think, if you're a fan of the mainstream comics in terms of the history of the characters, but it's completely baffling for new people. So this is a great book for learning to love the character, and I love it because basically what it is Thor gets trapped on Earth, he's sleeping on Jane Foster's couch, and he's learning to love the world, our world, while beating up bad guys. So it's a pretty straightforward
story. It's character-driven?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Oh, and Chris Samnee's art is really great, very
and
expressive.
It doesn't tie into any multiverse kind of retconning resets?
Nope, it's its own self-contained version of the universe, so yeah. You don't have to know... 50 years of history to get it. So
I bet it's funny too because it's Roger Langridge. Like it's got humor.
It's great. Yeah. So.
Well, cool. So then, Thor the Mighty Avenger by Roger Langridge. Can't recommend his stuff enough. Mm-hmm. All right.
The other thing about it is it's actually all ages, which all ages in the sense that it is accessible to people of many different ages. I know a lot of all ages books, people look at it and they think, oh, it's for kids, which is not a problem. I love all ages comics that are for kids.
Yeah.
Which
it could air on primetime TV. That's right. That's what this kind of all ages means, right?
It's okay. It could be a good family book, I would say.
Mm. All right. Now you've got something that Dan Mishkin has said was the single greatest superhero invented in the last 30 years.
And that is Static Shock from the late, great Dwayne McDuffie. And this volume is Rebirth of Ghoul. It has the first four issues from the original Static comic, as well as the four-issue miniseries called Rebirth of Cool. Static is, a superhero that controls electricity, but I think the best way to explain how great Static is to explain how he gets his powers. So you've got this nerdy black high school kid, he's like 14 years old, who's getting bullied and pushed around, and all the people in his life are kind of pushing him to the point where he ends up in this alley with a gun, and the bully is across the way. He has that moment where he's like, am I going to kill this bully and like be the man, which is what people are kind of saying to me. And he doesn't. But being there, he's in the right place at the right time or the wrong place at the wrong time. And he gets caught in this bang of mutagenic gas and gets his superpowers and becomes this superhero, Static Shock. It's a really great superhero book because it does have a lot of it's got the action and all that, we all love that in superhero books, but it's a great book for exploring the human dynamic little more deeply than a lot of superhero books do.
Okay. Dwayne McDuffie, amazing, right?
Oh yeah,
he made Justice League Unlimited the cartoon mm-hmm. that it was. Also, Dennis Cohen, what is prettier than his ink lines? For
true,
real, guys.
True.
I mean, anybody who's, even if you're just a fan of comic art, I can't get enough of that guy's ink lines. I mean, he's up there with like Simonson, with like that kind of energetic, loose, mm-hmm. vibrant ink line. Pretty.
It's definitely a book I like to read slowly.
Yeah, that's a good way of putting it. Okay, and then what's the final one on the list here?
The last thing is a much newer thing, and I'm kind of excited about it because I just read it last week. So, and that's Finding Gossamer, and this book. The basic premise is there's a brother and sister. The brother is, in the words of his sister, he's not a genius. It's just that he can't be wrong. He sees a problem, he solves it. He can't not solve it. So he's presented with this ancient mathematical theorem and push to solve it. And solving it opens this door to another fantastical world where math is basically magic. And it's not the only door that's open.
You have,
another...
this crazy green wizard doing, like, equations for his spells.
Oh, yeah, it's great. And it's, of course, they're not the only ones that enter a door through that world, and they're now trapped because what he has is the solution to the problem and not the problem itself, and he needs both to be able to travel. So he and his sister in this world. It's beautiful art. It's actually Sarah Ellerton, which I didn't realize until I started reading it, and kind of have a history with her. She is a webcomics artist. She did the self-contained webcomics Inverlock, Dreamless, and Phoenix or Queen, which are, Inverlock was one of my first webcomics, so I got really excited about that. But it's a very expressive sort of, I think they were kind of going towards a Pixar look. It's mentioned quite a few times in the back copy of the book.
Yeah, you can see it.
No hard lines, so it's not like, if you don't
digital
like...
Digital painterly style.
Very, yes, very much digital painterly style. And it's, the brother and sister relationship is really great in this. It's, the relationship is a lot more complex than I expected from this kind of book. The main character, Denny, the small boy, he actually seems to present as being on the autism spectrum. It's specifically never... diagnosed, as it were, in the book. I did a little poking on their Facebook. It's a question they're asked a lot. But it makes for a very complex kind of relationship between him and his sister, who has to act as his caregiver. Actually, on some level, it kind of reminds me of Lilo and Stitch in that respect. That's why I love Lilo and Stitch, is this interplay between the sisters and all that. Well, one of the reasons.
Yeah.
Favorite Disney movie. But anyway, it's a very good read, and, you know... You think with something where the magic of the world is math, it's going to be very didactic and kind of tiresome in that respect, but it's not. It's just math is magic. Isn't that awesome? Math is awesome. So
wow,
it's not a teachy book. If I know saying that math is magic in the world kind of gives that impression, it's not. It's just a pretty solid fantasy story.
But there's enough math that if I am somebody who is interested in mathematics or have like a passing interest, there'll be enough to make me more curious? Or no?
It's hard for me to really say. Like, they're not going around explaining mathematical concepts. There are theorems and things, and the visualization of the magic is these mathematical things. I don't think if you're wanting to like... see problems being solved, that this is the book for you, maybe. It's not like XKCD level of, you know, kind of mathematical humor or anything like that. But I know if I was a kid, like, I hated math as a child. I've only come to appreciate it as, you know, something beautiful, not something I want to do, but something beautiful as I've gotten older. But I think it's having that as part of the plot is a good way to trick a kid into thinking math might be okay.
Yeah.
Without actually making them do any of it.
Sometimes that's
not the primary thing.
Okay.
It's primarily, it's a fantasy world with a really strong characters and fun.
Oh, cool. Finding Gossamer. Is that what
And that's from, I believe, Third World.
Never heard of them.
The writer is David A. Rodriguez, and apparently he is the lead writer for Skylanders Swap Force, which I know is pretty popular with the kids, so that's another way to kind of get them interested, perhaps.
Love Skylanders. I'm bummed out that Swap Force, you have to get the new system. I was like holding out, like, I'm not getting the new system, and then like, oh, Swap Force.
I am a poor college student. I have none of the systems.
All right, so Jason, I'm wondering what you have on your recommended list for this episode.
Well, I wanted to recommend a series of books called The Drifting Classroom by Kazuo Umezu. Now, this was a manga series written in the 70s by one of my favorite, probably my favorite cartoonist of all time. One thing I like to do as a cartoonist is, I don't know if you play this game with your cartoonist friends, but I like to imagine if I could have any career from the history of comics, whose career would I want? And it usually comes down to either Yoshihiro Tatsumi, who did A Drifting Life most recently, or Kazuo Umezu. He's a horror writer who started off in the 50s doing horror manga, girls manga, and then as his career evolved over the course of about 50 years, he just went bananas and started doing these really ambitious projects, and the horror got more horrific.
Yeah, I'm seeing an explicit content tag on the cover of the Drifting Classroom as I'm looking at it.
Yeah, he's probably like I said, he's probably my favorite living cartoonist. And the nice thing about Japanese careers is you get to see they have like a really nice sort of early, middle, and late stage to their careers. And the stuff he was doing, the last project he did before he died was this insane book called 14, which, yeah, just goes on for, I think, 20-something volumes. But I think probably his greatest achievement was this book he did in the 70s called A Drifting Classroom. And the premise is pretty simple. Or it starts off pretty simple, which is these kids, they're going to school, and suddenly there's an earthquake. After the earthquake's over, the kids look outside of the window, and outside the schoolyard, or outside the boundaries of the school, is a desert wasteland that stretches on for infinity. The kids, at first, they don't know what happened, but they eventually figure it out that they've been transported into the future. And I guess the humans have not been very good stewards of the environment, because the Earth is now this this giant desert with giant scorpion bugs roaming the desert. So at that point, it basically turns into a Lord of the Flies type situation. And the kids have to learn how to survive with limited resources. It just gets crazier and crazier with every volume. And the whole thing is 11 volumes. Wow. I was able to get all 11 copies at the San Francisco Public Library. They had the entire set, which was great, because it would, I imagine, for an average comics fan, it would be difficult buying all 11 volumes. It's great being able to read them, being able to read library copies. Yeah. And it, gosh, I don't know what else to say about it other than it is a masterpiece. So I would highly recommend it, and I'll tell you one little more tidbit about this cartoonist Kazuo Umezu, which is I love this cartoonist so much that I named my own son Kazuo
after the cartoonist.
After the cartoonist.
Wow, wow. Okay, that's as high of an endorsement as you could possibly make. So it looks like this came out from Viz a while back, so we'll have to see about it. I didn't find it in the AADL collection. We'll have to see about getting it for AADL's collection. It looks pretty awesome.
Yeah, it was great. Probably one of my favorite manga series of all time.
Wow. The Drifting Classroom by Kazuo Umezu? Is that how you see his last name?
That's right. And I'll tell you one more thing. on our honeymoon, my wife and I went to Tokyo, and I managed to track down Kazuo Umezu's house, and I rung his doorbell.
Did he answer?
He did not answer.
Oh, that would have been such a great ending to the story.
Who knows? Maybe he heard it ring. I don't know.
He was like, I don't know that guy. Well, it's possible that in years to come he will know of you, and then he will ring your doorbell, because my book recommendation is going to be Empire State, because I just reread it in preparation for this episode, and it is a very sweet slice of life sort of narrative that doesn't do any of the navel-gazing that Slice of Life gets a bad rap for. Because there's really great Slice of Life stuff, like Derek Kirk Kim's stuff, but then there's also stuff where it's like, okay, well, this is really kind of like reading a 17-year-old's diary. And that's for a certain audience, too, right? There are some people who want to read that. But what I love about this is that it doesn't feel like Jason's taking... And I'm giving you a review while you're standing here. This is uncomfortable, but it doesn't feel like it didn't feel like Jason was taking any like extreme position one way or the other. There's a scene where the main character who has feelings for this girl, he meets the girl's new beau. Like she moves away, he goes to visit her. He goes through this heartbreaking journey to go visit her. And he gets there, and she's got another guy, right? And you know what to expect from that moment, right? We've seen the movies. We've seen the Meg Ryan and Tom Hanks movies and all those kinds of movies where what that moment is supposed to be like. And the way Jason plays it is so subtle, and you don't take a position on that other guy. He's actually a pretty nice guy. He's a really nice guy. I think the word was avuncular in the book. And I feel like that's the tone of this thing is, like, it's really you... You get to have your own reactions to some of these things in the story, although there are some truly, you know, terrible, heartbreaking moments within as well. But it was really surprising how ambiguous a lot of the moments where I expected a corny dun-dun-dun. Instead, I got this moment where I was walking away questioning, well, was that such a bad thing? You know, was our hero wrong in going to find her after all? You know, should I not be rooting for him in this situation? So hats off to you for that. And I think a lot of people should read the book as a result of that.
You know, I have to say, I just love how you use color as part of the story as well. Yeah. It's really, really excellent.
Yeah, we should say, because like, there's a lot of time jumping in this book, too. A lot of like going back and forth. And so different scenes will have different colors as part of the cue for that, I think, as well.
Yes, I have to give credit where credit is due. John Pham did the colors for Empire State.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Okay.
But yeah, he used it to great effect to sort of clarify the sort of chronology of the events in the book. So the original version of Empire State was actually a mini comic, and which was in black and white, and it was I think it was pretty confusing for readers figuring out where they were in the story. Because it would jump around in time fairly abruptly, but yeah, man, once John added those colors, it was pretty clear. Except when I didn't want it to be where the reader was in time in the story.
Mm. Is that where like the colors become mixed, where you'll have both blue and red in some of the sequences?
That's the part where I didn't want the reader to know what when those parts of the story took place.
Yeah, whether it was before or after his trip.
Yeah.
Wow. See, now I got to read it again with that in mind. Okay, well, gosh, guys, this was a super, super fun episode. Thank you so much, Jason, for being on the show at long last and hanging out with me. I hope we can do it again.
Yeah, me too.
So if people listen to this and watched it and they said, gosh, that Jason Shiga, he is just something else. I need to get more of that guy in my life. Where's the one place they should go to find out more about you and what you're up to lately?
Let's see. Well, I guess they could visit my website, which is shigabooks.com, or they can just Google my name, Jason Shiga, and I think they can find my website that way pretty quickly. I think, other than that, I'd say go to your local library and ask if they have any books by Jason Shiga.
That's a really good idea, actually. Go to your local library or your school library and say, where are the Jason Shiga books, please? And then, Rachel, is there anything going on that we need to talk about in terms of local events?
Well, we've got our upcoming Comics Artist Forum, of course, which is going to be April 6th here at the library from 1 to 3. And we've got, and I'm going to butcher his name again. Joshua Hoke. I wanted to say Hokey, but that's not right. Hoke of Tales of the Brother 3. Uh-huh. And he's going to be here talking to us about taking stories from your life and turning it into comics. And then maybe not directly comics related, but we have a couple other things folks might want to know about. We've got the Emerging Writers Workshop, which is this Thursday, March 20th, from 7 to 8:45 at our Traverwood branch. And that's just sort of a get-together of people who are writers, aspiring writers. We have a couple local authors there that will be acting as a resource. That's Laura Zeelan and Margaret Young. So if you want to come up by and chat about writing, that's a place to do it.
Traverwood branch, you said?
Traverwood branch.
Okay.
Thursday, March 20th. And then we have Nerd Night Ann Arbor, which is now free because the library is covering your costs. So that's going to be Thursday the 27th. That's going to be an adult event because it is at Live. There will be adult beverages present. And it's kind of like...
as they call them in Texas, refreshments.
Yes. So that's kind of, if you don't know about Nerd Night, it's kind of like short Discovery Channel style presentations on all kinds of crazy topics. I know there was... one, I think, last time on, like, the science of beer making and something about 3D printing. And so it covers a wide range of topics. And so that's going to be Thursday the 27th from 6:30 to 9:30 at Live, which is on First Street. And then the last thing I want to let people know about is we're actually working to add some more content and stuff to our comics website here at AADL, and that's comics.aadl.org. So I now have a email address I can give you guys, which is comics@aadl.org. And if you email us there, we're going to start taking art submissions. If anyone wants to like submit a comic to put on the library website, we're going to start trying to build an artist directory for folks in the area, and then just create a list of resources. So if there's anything you think that everybody else that's a comics creator should know about, I don't know. We got
like
things.
Like Wally Wood's 22 panels that always work. That
for sure,
thing.
That's on my list. Yeah. So is the Disney Animators Toolkit, things like Pixlr.com, stuff like Fire Alpaca, anything of that nature. Any kind of stuff about podcasting, I know you have quite a few links about that.
Oh, that's
so
right, yeah.
Anything that you think that another artist might be interested in that we can link around. So
sweet. So that's comics@aadl.org is the
that's
email
correct.
Address. Oh, awesome. All right. Well, I got a couple other local events as well in at EMU, Eastern Michigan University. There's a comics gallery show going on until April 16th. Original art curated by art history professor Richard Rubenfeld. It's called Kapow.
They've got some great stuff over there. They've got, what, Jeff Smith, David Peterson.
Cool.
One of the Kuberts, I think.
Oh.
So.
That's at art.emich.edu, but we'll put the full link in the show notes. And then also the 28th through the 30th in Mount Clemens, Michigan, there's a new comic convention starting in Michigan called the Deluxe Entertainment Expo. Interesting idea for this one. It's actually like a comics slash martial arts event.
You know, I did see something about that.
Did you see that? Yeah, and like I talked with the guy who runs it because he invited me to come, and he was talking about how, you know, like, well, martial arts teaches young people discipline, self-confidence, and solving problems, and he didn't see any disparity between that and what, you know, good comics for young people teaches them. So he thought, that why not those two worlds collide? So it'll be interesting. It's in Mount Clemens. It's at the Gibraltar Trade Center.
Okay,
so.
I think I saw that there was going to be quite a few martial arts demonstrations there. So
yeah, and they're going for some world records, like the most Ninja Turtle costumes in one place. Because Kevin Eastman's going to be there doing
All
some
right.
talks, and I'm going to be leading some workshops for kids at that event. So that's at DLUXExpo.com. So, all right. This episode will be archived at comicsaregreat.com/CAG95. Thank you, Rachel Moyer, for the great book recommendations. Thank you to Jason Shiga for the great talk. Thanks to Matt Dubay and Eric Closter in the control room, keeping track of all the links and doing all the television switching. Until next time, everybody, I've been Jersey Drozd of comicsaregreat.com and Jersey on Twitter. Okay, bye.